Merci.
We're going to get started in about a minute. So if you could please take your seats. Is my mic live?
No.
Not yet.
Good morning. Testing, testing.
I'm going to take the sucker seat.
Okay.
Great.
Okay.
Hello, Pierce.
Good morning.
Sir?
So, good morning, everyone. Welcome. It's about 5 minutes past the hour, so I think we're going to get started. This is pretty informal, so feel free to mill about and get some breakfast if you haven't had a chance. It's really great to see everyone. We're going to have our discussion this morning for the next hour and a half about safeguarding bioscience and biotechnology. We'll be talking about a new organization, IBBIS, and the International Common Mechanism for DNA Synthesis Screening. This event is organized by NTI in partnership with this new organization, IBBIS. So NTI is a global security organization that's nonpartisan and nonprofit. We're based in Washington, D.C., and our focus is to our mission is to reduce nuclear and biological risks that imperil humanity. My name is Jamie Ossoff. I'm the Vice President of Global Biological Policy and Programs at NTI, and so I'm responsible for the biorisk reduction part of NTI's mission. And we have a really great lineup today. I'm looking forward to our discussions. So here's a quick high-level summary of our agenda this morning. We're just gonna do some brief opening remarks, and then we're gonna have about a half-hour presentation with Piers Millett, Nicole Wheeler, and myself to give an overview on efforts to safeguard bioscience and biotechnology. I'm gonna offer a high-level sort of overview about why this work is needed. Nicole will talk about our work on DNA synthesis screening, and then Piers will talk about IBBIS. Then we're going to move to a moderated discussion. We have two guests from the DNA synthesis community, James Diggin and Sylvain. From DNA Script, and they'll be offering their perspective from industry on the remarks that we're sharing this morning. And then we'll open the floor to interactive Q&A with the attendees. And at the end, Piers will wrap up with a few closing remarks about IBBIS and the vision forward, and we have a new video about IBBIS that we're premiering today. Okay, let's see. So safeguarding bioscience and biotechnology, here are illustrious speakers. So it's myself, Nicole Wheeler, who's a research fellow at the University of Birmingham. And Nicole is our technical lead for our Common Mechanism for DNA Synthesis Screening. And she's been working with us at NTI for a number of years as we work to build this tool. Piers is the inaugural executive director from IBBIS. He just joined us in October to help us manage a transition as we work to incubate and launch IBBIS. And we're really excited that he's stepped into this role. And you'll be hearing more from both of them in a few minutes. Okay, technology advances in emerging biorisks. So I'll start with a few framing remarks about why we think this issue is important, what the risks are, and some of the initial thinking about what we should do to address them. And so I'll start with the bottom line up front. I don't think this is a surprising statement to anyone. You know, technology advances offer tremendous opportunities, including for advancing bioscience and biotechnology, but they also pose risks, and we need to recognize both sides of that coin if we're gonna really be thoughtful about how we manage technology developments in the bioscience domain. And so when I talk about advances, I wanted to offer a little more specifics about what I mean. So a really critical part of this is that it's easier to read, write, and edit DNA and RNA, and that's the fundamental blueprint for all living systems on Earth. You can see a small chart in the upper right-hand corner of the slide. It's hard to read, but basically these are this is a plot prepared by Rob Carlson, and it's the takeaway here is that the cost of synthesizing and sequencing DNA over the past in recent decades has declined exponentially. So there's basically the cost of printing a single base pair or a length of gene is basically just decreasing dramatically. Our colleagues in the DNA synthesis community have experienced this directly and can share more about that. And so, it's not only cheaper, it's faster, and it's easier, and the capabilities are increasingly distributed. And so that really matters for our abilities to fundamentally engineer biological systems. But I think in order to have a big picture understanding, it's also important to to recognize that there are adjacent technologies from other fields that are interacting with biosciences that are driving these advances. We've offered a few examples here. So advances in artificial intelligence and robotics are making it possible to automate experiments and take them at scale, take them to scale and also design new types of experiments. It's been possible for quite a while to outsource certain experiments. So there are certain cloud labs where you can basically order a DNA. You can order an experiment over the internet and they'll do it for you. Here's an image on the bottom right of what some of these cloud labs look like. And then a newer capability that's on the horizon is the ability to predict protein folding and also to design proteins. And the reason proteins matter is because they're basically, if you think about like a cell as the factory floor, the like protein is like the machinery in the factory that's doing the work. And so if you can design new machines inside of cells, you can really design all sorts of important systems. And so that's a really important development. Okay. So what does this mean for pathogens? And so I think leaving a few like big picture statements. So first of all, it's easier than it ever has been to make pathogens from scratch, from their DNA components, or to modify them to make them more dangerous by making them more transmissible among human populations, to make them more virulent, or to make them resistant to vaccines and therapeutics. And in fact, there are researchers that for legitimate reasons are using these tools and capabilities to do scientific experiments. They're synthesizing modifying pathogens, and there are a few examples on the right of papers that people have published to document that work. You know, one classic example is back in 2017, some researchers in Canada reconstituted an extinct pox virus, horse pox virus, using $100,000 in mail order DNA. Horse pox virus itself isn't dangerous, but it's a close cousin of smallpox. So that's an example of the kind of things that are underway right now. Okay, so we're at the Biological Weapons Convention. What does this mean for biological risks? Why should we care? And I think that the bottom line up front is it means that a wider range of actors can engineer pathogens for legitimate purposes or otherwise. And so in terms of the kinds of risks we're worried about, it means that it's easier for a non-state actor to engineer a pathogen or synthesize a pathogen and carry out an attack with something that's more sophisticated or potentially more dangerous than what might have been possible before. There's also an increased risk of severe accidents. You know, we know that accidents happen. There are data to show that there are human errors or mechanical failures, but the extent to which an accident happens with an engineered pathogen that's more dangerous than a natural pathogen, that carries more risk, and we need to be cognizant of that. And the last point I'll make on this is just that, which is a more speculative one, is it's possible that the ability to engineer living systems will shape bioweapons risks posed by states because it might shape their cost-benefit analysis of whether or not they should consider exploring that as a possibility. But that's a little bit more speculative. Okay, so DNA synthesis and screening. DNA synthesis is a fundamental technology that underpins molecular biology research and biotechnology. It's used in labs in countries around the world, and it's critical. It's getting faster, cheaper, and more accessible. And screening both the orders that come in and the customers to make sure that you're not selling dangerous materials to actors that shouldn't have those materials, that's voluntary. It's not legally required in any country around the world. We have a very rough estimate from a number of years ago that about 80% of global market share is screened, but we don't really know, and we should probably do better research to document that more carefully. The International Gene Synthesis Consortium is a group of DNA synthesis companies that have banded together to share best practices and voluntarily screen orders. James is currently serving as the head of the IGSC, so the industry is really leaning forward and is trying to do the right thing and is really providing a leadership role. The other thing that's important to note is that in addition to these centralized DNA providers where you can basically order DNA on the internet and have it mailed to your house, there are new benchtop synthesis devices that are coming online that are making it easier to basically print out DNA on your benchtop or in your lab. You don't have to have it mailed to you. You can just do it in your own facility. These capabilities have been around for a while, but the newer benchtop devices are easier to use. And the capabilities right now are fairly basic, but it's likely to improve in the next 2 to 5 years. And we have to think about biosecurity safeguards for these systems to make sure that the kind of screening practices that are put in place for traditional synthesis are applying to this new distributed approach. We've been working on this for quite a while because we think this is a key issue. We partnered with the World Economic Forum and published a report in January of 2020. And it put out a couple of key recommendations, including establishing a technical consortium to develop a DNA screening tool that could be used internationally, and establishing an international organization that could strengthen global biosecurity norms and guidelines. And then we basically went out and took our own advice and tried to build these systems that we were recommending. So we convened the first technical consortium in May of 2020. You know, there's extensive industry collaboration and international representation, and this work is being done in close partnership with the International Gene Synthesis Consortium, or the IGSC. And there are, we've been continuously convening this group for the last 3 years, and there are basically three key areas that we're focused on in this context. One is developing the common mechanism that Nicole will talk about in a moment. One of them is developing a more robust framework for screening your customers, not just your orders, because it's a critical part of it. And one is ensuring integration with benchtop devices, which I was just describing a moment ago. Okay, so we have a video, a brief video, that talks through our DNA synthesis screening work. It's about 2 minutes long, so just hit play. And
DNA is the blueprint for life on Earth, controlling every biological function of every living organism. Today, DNA synthesis technology allows scientists to modify that blueprint, enabling advances in agriculture, manufacturing, public health, and more. Gaining access to DNA synthesis technology is rapidly becoming easier, accelerating the pace of these scientific advances. However, this could also make it easier for some states or extremist groups to develop harmful biological agents. Many DNA synthesis providers are already screening DNA orders to prevent harmful uses, comparing customer orders against a database of known threats. But the cost and time required to screen DNA orders can be a barrier for many providers, and there is no globally accepted standard for reviewing and assessing DNA orders. We must do more to protect this valuable technology from exploitation. NTI and the World Economic Forum are bringing together leading experts to develop a shared international system or common mechanism to make DNA synthesis screening feasible and effective for all providers. This global, open-source common mechanism will make it easier for providers to screen DNA sequences efficiently at lower cost. It will also provide guidance on how to screen customers and will integrate with customer-operated benchtop synthesis devices, new DIY technology that allows scientists to synthesize DNA in their own labs. The common mechanism would give every provider access to DNA synthesis order screening tools, resulting in improved global biosecurity and biosafety. The production of synthetic DNA is essential to the global bioeconomy and public health advances. It must be safeguarded against deliberate misuse by malicious actors. We must act now to establish stronger biosecurity protections for DNA synthesis. Join our international effort to universalize DNA synthesis screening for a safer world.
Okay, great. So we prepared that video just to help as a communication tool to explain what we mean. Now it's my pleasure to hand over the floor to Nicole Wheeler, who's going to be talking about the common mechanism.
Thank you, Jamie. The work that we've been doing around DNA synthesis screening sort of started with talking to our international technical consortium and understanding the flow of actions and decisions that need to be taken when deciding whether to ship an order to a customer or not. So this DNA synthesis screening process progresses along a number of steps that look at both the person who's trying to order the DNA and the DNA that they're trying to order. It starts when the customer creates an account with a company, at which point we need to assess whether the customer is safe and legal to work with. And then when a customer goes to place an order, we look at the shipping and payment conditions to check that they're appropriate. So are they trying to pay with cash or an untraceable payment mechanism? Are they trying to ship to a PO box? Things like that. If those conditions look appropriate, then we will look at the DNA that they're trying to order to determine whether it's safe to work with. If it is, then the order can be shipped. But if any flags are raised, Then there's some follow-up screening that needs to happen to look at the nature of the DNA being ordered and the customer's stated intended use to see if the use is appropriate and whether it's been approved, if necessary, by a biosafety officer or similar. So when we're looking at the DNA itself in trying to decide whether it could potentially pose a hazard, we've put together this international common mechanism to help companies make that assessment. It consists of, firstly, a set of databases that we can compare orders to try and determine what the order contains and whether that could potentially pose a hazard. We also have developed software that helps us perform that screening, so how we compare the order to the database and how we start to answer a series of questions through those comparisons. And finally, we're also developing, in collaboration with our users, a decision support system to help people who are using the common mechanism understand the decisions that it's making and have meaningful conversations with the customer about what they intend to do with that DNA. So when we're looking at the DNA to try to decide whether it could potentially pose a hazard, there are a number of key questions that we need to answer. The first one is whether or not a customer's order contains a gene or a biological part that potentially poses a concern. If it does, we would flag that for further attention. If it doesn't, we also want to understand whether that piece of DNA or a piece of DNA within it has been taken from a pathogen that's subject to certain regulations, like if it's on the select agents list. If it's not, then that order can pass for synthesis, but if some of that DNA has been taken from a regulated pathogen, we need to start to understand what kind of function it performs. If it's a harmless function, and we don't think it poses any particular risk, then that can be synthesized, but if it's a known harmful function or it's of unknown function, we might need to do further investigation. So the first question that we're trying to answer is, does this order contain a gene of concern? And for this, we've developed a biorisk screening pipeline. So what this aims to do is look through the DNA and identify a biological part that poses a potential risk. To do this, we've curated a set of genes that we refer to as biorisks. And at the moment, these contain genes that are themselves subject to regulations, like a select agent toxin, and also genes carried by regulated pathogens that are known to participate in causing disease. Alongside the list of genes that we think we should flag, we also have a means of detecting them. And to do this, we've collected for each of these biological parts publicly available sequences that encode them, and we've looked at all of these sequences of the same biological part from across nature to understand how it's able to vary and mutate and still perform the same biological function. This has allowed us to construct a sequence profile for each of these genes that allows us to identify a wide range of examples, as well as sequences that have potentially been manipulated by a person to look dissimilar to what you see in nature, but still fold and function in the same way and pose the same hazard. So that's to identify genes of concern. We also need to understand whether the DNA has been taken from a regulated pathogen, and to do this, we will take the order and compare it to sequences, again, in publicly available DNA and protein databases to find which publicly available sequences are most similar to different parts of that order. We then look at the organisms that those sequences have come from and cross-check them against international lists of controlled pathogens. And if any part of the order contains a sequence that's a better match to a regulated pathogen than anything else, that's then passed on for further inspection. However, for most regulated pathogens, they have a lot of DNA in them. Most of that DNA doesn't actually participate in causing harm in any way. And some of that DNA has a very well-known harmless function. And there are very good reasons why customers might want to order these parts. So we then check for these very well-known harmless biological parts, and if that's all the customer is trying to order, and then we can pass that and say there's no need for further concern.
Okay, so that's a sort of technical deep dive into how we're building this tool, but just to zoom out and think about, you know, a lot of people here are associated with governments, and government has a really critical role to play. And I'll just offer a couple high-level points. Right now, there's no globally agreed standard for conducting DNA synthesis screening, and it is voluntary. And so this is really putting a provocative question on the table. Should we be working together as a community toward globally agreed standards for DNA synthesis screening, recognizing that if there are critical gaps in this practice anywhere in the world, it creates significant vulnerabilities for everyone? A key building block for working toward globally agreed standards is national level guidance. Individual governments need to figure out what they believe is the right path for managing this within their respective borders. Most governments do not have national level guidance. The US government issued the first round of national level guidance in 2010, which was largely a reflection of the practices that industry had already discussed internationally. It's a bit out of date at this point, and now the US government is working to update it. They published a revised guidance draft this spring and solicited feedback from the community. A number of members from the community, including from our technical consortium, offered feedback to help make this guidance better. But basically what's happening right now is that the US guidance, because it's used by the International Gene Synthesis Consortium, is functioning as a de facto international set of guidance. And you know, we believe that taking a more international approach here would be advisable, and it'd be great to see more governments step into the fray and develop national level approaches to this and to work toward a global standard. I also wanted to offer just a brief plug for some work we've been doing on biosecurity for benchtop synthesis devices. So as I mentioned a few minutes ago, this is a sort of new development within the market that's leading to decentralization of DNA synthesis capabilities. And so we wanted to better understand what is the state of play of DNA synthesis capabilities in benchtop devices? What does that mean for biosecurity, and what should we do about it? What are the kinds of governance approaches that we can put into place that would most effectively safeguard this technology? So we conducted interviews with more than 30 experts, including a number of leading industry players, and we prepared a report, and we're planning to publish it soon. So watch this space. We'll be sharing more news about this in the coming weeks. And so, now it's my pleasure to turn the floor over to peers who've been talking about home for the common mechanism.
So we have this new international common mechanism. Where is it going to sit? This is a pleasurable opportunity to introduce the International Biosecurity and Biosafety Initiative for Science. This is a new independent international organization who, unsurprisingly, you will hear, first job is to house the international common mechanism. As we all know, the rapid biotechnological advances outpace the ability of governments to provide effective oversight and prevent accidents or deliberate misuse of those advances. The aim of IBBIS is to engage public and private sector stakeholders to develop stronger global biosecurity norms and practical governance approaches to guard against emerging biological risks. So just to highlight two things in there, there's the practical tools and there is the governance and the norm setting activities. You can see that we have mapped out a mission and a vision for IBBIS that sits very comfortably with the issues you're here in Geneva to discuss. It sits parallel to the Biological Weapons Convention and shares similar objectives in such as aiming for a world in which bioscience and biotechnology can flourish safely and responsibly whilst looking at some of the ways that we can manage some of the risks for accidental and deliberate misuse. This work is intended to be undertaken to safeguard science and reduce the risk of catastrophic events that could result from the deliberate abuse or the accidental misuse of bioscience and biotechnology. IBBIS will be small, it will be agile, it will be quick and flexible. At the moment, I am the entirety of IBBIS. So 100% of the organization is in the room. You can see here on the slide some idea of our vision of how it will move forward. Very keen to have international support and international insights through a board of directors that represents the aims and objectives of the organization, but that will then draw on external expertise through in a technical consortia and then bring folks on board as we develop projects. And so firstly, as I mentioned, the International Common Mechanism will be the first topic, so we will have some staff specifically to support that particular initiative. It's not the only thing IBBIS will do. As you know, as you've been talking about for a very long time, and those folks that have been in the BWC meeting last week, there is a life cycle of science and technology development, moving from the early stages of designing what happens in a lab through the operational aspects of what then actually happens when the research is conducted and then what comes out the other end, whether that's in an academic setting, for example, through publications or through an industrial setting and comes out as some form of intellectual property. There are a number of opportunities to intervene in that life cycle to make sure that, that we are seeing benefits whilst managing any risks. We can see individual spots to create a layered defence there, with the international common mechanism being just one of the tools that we could put in place. Based upon that, you will be unsurprised to understand that along with NTI, there's some been thinking going along about other tools and approaches that could be introduced to other intervention points along that life cycle. For example, how can we support and strengthen the work that science funders are involved with deciding what research moves ahead? As I mentioned, publication is a key point in that. How could, do we support the publishers in being able to identify and shape the publications that come through their journals in a way that, that keeps the science that we need to see in the public domain but manages some of those risks? Certainly we can work with governments. We can certainly actually then start working with those that are conducting the science, doing the research, developing the technologies, and using the key tools and approaches in a way to help them bring out the benefits whilst minimizing the risks. And one final area just to mention briefly is the possibility of how do we reward good practice? We're going to get onto good practice in a minute. We're going to see some of the people and the companies that have really excelled in this space and demonstrate that, that governments are not alone in working with this. How do we recognize that? How do we endorse that? How do we incentivize more people, more companies in more places to become part of that solution? Don't try and read the whole slide. The left-hand side of the slide is simply to say, I'm sure you've seen the new WHO guidance. Recognize as part of that is that there are some gaps in the current system. There are things that we can do to build capacities that are useful. And you will see here that the aims and objectives of IBBIS are intentionally mapping across to identified gaps and needs that the international system already has. So IBBIS is meant to work with and not compete with the procedures and practices being put in place at the, by intergovernmental and international bodies. It's not all about the international. You can see on here that national governments also have a key role to play. I know that will be surprising to many of you who actually work for national governments. IBBIS is there as a tool, as a resource to help you do what you need to do. We hope to benefit from your knowledge, experience, and insights and work collaboratively to provide tools and guidance that enable countries to balance that. How do we make biotechnology work and get the benefits with the biosafety and biosecurity concerns that run throughout that system? It should serve as a resource to address challenges that you know about and really enable a multi-sectoral response that will hopefully help you meet the aims and objectives, not only of the Biological Weapons Convention, but of other international and national objectives at the same time. The good news is we have a placeholder website up. If you'd like to know more about IBBIS, you will, there'll be an even bigger QR code at the end of this. So don't try and zoom in on this one. Just to say that at the moment there's some basic information on the organization that's up there. That will be changing, it will be evolving, it will be adding as we start standing IBBIS up over the coming months. And now we're at the discussion point.
Great.
Jamie, I'll hand that back to you.
Great. So thanks so much. So that's a quick overview of our work on the common mechanism and our vision for IBBIS. And now we're going to turn to two discussants from the DNA synthesis industry to share their perspective on this work. We're really lucky to have James Diggins, who's head of biosecurity for Twist Bioscience and head of the IGSC, and Sylvain Gariel, who's a co-founder and chief operating officer of DNA Script. Each of them will share a few minutes of reflections on this work, and then we'll open the floor to interactive discussion with the full panel. So without further ado, I'm happy to turn the floor over to James.
Thank you, Jamie. So I appreciate the opportunity to both participate in this work as well as to be here today and kind of give some industry reflection on the impact that I think this work will have. So as Jamie said, I am privileged to lead the International Gene Synthesis Consortium right now. This is a group of more than 20 companies around the world that participate in DNA synthesis. The industry is deeply international, both the companies that are capable of synthesizing DNA as well as the customer base. So while the U.S. has provided national guidance, from the beginning, industry has always considered this to be a deeply international problem and one that requires a lot of agreement and working across those company boundaries. So those companies are fierce competitors in the marketplace, but still come together at the IGSC to sort of agree upon best practices in biosecurity so that we can all ensure that the material that we make is used in a responsible research context. So things like harmonizing the idea that we don't ship to residential addresses, we don't ship to PO boxes, and how at a very high level we engage in sequence screening. The one thing that has always been a challenge for the IGSC is these sequence screening systems are always implemented by individual companies behind those company firewalls. And while there's a lot of discussion around shared practices, what there has never been has been what the NTI has accomplished, which is to build one of these things in a very collaborative setting in which you have the technical consortium where lots of industry representation, international representation was present, and weighing in on all of these technical choices that have to be made around how a screening system should be constructed. And so I think the common mechanism is going to serve an incredibly valuable purpose in terms of not just lowering the cost associated with screening for smaller DNA synthesis companies, which is a huge advantage, but also helping even larger organizations think through, you know, making technical choices to make sure that the performance of their screening systems in terms of accuracy and speed is at parity with the sort of cutting edge choices that NTI has made in their implementation. And the last thing I'll say is one thing that industry has really struggled with consistently has been trying to engage on the international stage, you know, it's in the UN process and things like that. That's why we're really excited about this IBBIS organization, because that gives industry kind of a nexus into that community whereby we can benefit from a lot of the activities that are going on and things like the BWC and other organizations that might be difficult otherwise for industry to engage in. So we're really excited to support and participate in IBBIS as it grows and matures. Thank you.
Great. Thanks so much, James. Sylvain?
Thanks so much for having me. Jamie, it's a pleasure to be here with you guys today. So the DNA Script has a different approach from Twist from a business model perspective. We're essentially providing our customers with the ability to make the DNA themselves by opposition to DNA as a service, which in the last 20 years has been the main the main source or the main business model in the industry. And so we came up a few years ago with a new technology that's based essentially on using enzymes and biology to make the DNA that has historically been made using organic chemistry. And so it comes with a new set of challenges, because it means all of a sudden we are enabling people in a very easy and user-friendly way to make the DNA they need themselves. It's not a new idea in the sense that this is essentially how this industry started back in the 80s. And since the 80s, thousands of benchtop DNA printers were sold by different industry players until the early 2000s, where there was like a very big consolidation and a big outsourcing wave that led to the current industry structure and companies like Twist, who are bringing a much more efficient way of operating those services. The reason we think the benchtop ID is becoming very important and will solve specific needs in the industry is because new applications have emerged. I can just name a few to give you a sense of you know, where the industry is at. So one example is obviously related to infectious diseases. We've seen during the pandemic that in many cases, the service model has limitations in terms of turnaround time and speed. And you know, we had examples during the pandemic. For example, the CDC struggled at the beginning of the pandemic in the US to develop a new assay. Part of it was because it was really challenging to source the material that was needed to develop those assays. And benchtop systems put the capability back in the end of the users, and they can iterate faster. Of course, it does come with its own set of challenges. And so the way we've been thinking about it and discussing with NTI, of course, and today IBBIS, is really a three-layered approach where, first of all, everything starts with customer screening. We need to make sure that, as you mentioned, James, the users of or the producers of synthetic DNA have legitimate reasons to do what they want to do. So that's really kind of the first gating item. The second one is, of course, sequence screening. And the way we've been thinking about it is because those benchtop systems can be used by certain legitimate users in a setup that's not connected to the internet. There may not be a way for providers like ourselves to know what's going on a daily basis with the systems. And so in that case, you need to embed the system, the screening system, into the benchtop printer. So that's kind of the second layer, which is making sure that whatever is happening on this system is legitimate, and if it's not, it can be blocked. And then the third layer of our approach is really kind of fundamentally linked to the business model, which is we're providing not just the system, but also the reagents. And the reagents are proprietary, and we're the only provider of those reagents in the world. So we have a very good sense of what the users are doing with the systems, because they always have to come back to us to ask for more reagents. So this is how we're thinking about it. Obviously, none of this is perfect, and this is why we're so excited to be here today, to be able to improve our approach and make it safer for everybody. Sorry, I was a little bit long.
No, that was fantastic. Thank you so much. So. I think we're really grateful. You know, you guys are both involved in for-profit businesses where time is money, and we're extremely grateful that you've come out to Geneva to join us for these discussions. And both of your organizations have been really steadfast in participating in our technical consortium and in our work to develop the common mechanism and our sort of research on benchtop devices. And so we really are grateful for your time and your expertise and your effort. And I just want to stress that the DNA synthesis community, both the traditional DNA synthesis providers and now benchtop providers, I think are a real model for industry responsibility and biosecurity. They've been really leaning forward to try to be proactive and creative and innovative and building in biosecurity by design as they build up their systems. And I think this relationship with industry and this approach by industry is a real model that I'm hoping we can emulate in other aspects of biotechnology industry as we look to build in biosecurity by design. So thank you for all the work, and we look forward to continuing to partner with both of you. So we've got some time for interactive discussion now. My colleague Chris has a microphone, and so we welcome questions or comments from the audience. So if you'd like to speak, please raise your hand and we'll deliver the mic to you, and we'll happily take your comments and questions. And if you could please introduce yourself when you ask your question. Yeah. Thank you.
Yeah, so good morning. My name is Sam Bontiankuma from Public Health Agency of Canada. And I'm very delighted to be here with you. I just kind of find it very interesting how these are connected together. My first question goes to, I think, Michelle?
Nicole, sorry.
Yeah, basically, when you talk about flagging, you talk mm-hmm. about flagging at different stages. You are doing your risk assessment,
yep.
flagging your clients, and making mm-hmm. sure they actually basically meet a certain standard that you are looking for. Now, when you say flagging, are you flagging it to the regulators that this particular client is going to use this technology for something you don't know about, or what are you flagging? Secondly, one of the things that we normally, as government, is kind of difficult to understand is we like to have innovation. At the same time, we want to balance the risk with that particular approach. And sometimes it's very difficult to find the right balance, right? And normally, it's always looking at maybe academia and researchers to understand their responsibilities in managing this particular risk, right? And in your particular case, how do you ensure that they can, normally your first client is not a big problem. And as it was mentioned here, your first client is not the biggest problem. It's your second and maybe your third client that may be the problem. how do you make sure that when your first client gets this particular technology, that technology is not going to be spilled over to a third client somewhere you don't know about? How do you actually manage that particular risk?
Great, thank you. Nicole, do you want to take the first question?
Sure.
And the second question, I'm sure people across the panel may have some thoughts on that.
Yeah, I'm really glad that you asked a bit more about the flagging. It's been a really important part of our discussions with the technical consortium of what happens once a piece of software raises something for attention. It does depend a little bit on the DNA synthesis company or the benchtop synthesis device in question. So certain companies like Twist have a lot of resources in place already to deal with flagged orders. And usually a flag doesn't mean a customer cannot buy something. It just means more attention needs to be paid and we need to see whether these conditions are appropriate for shipping or not. So it's often the beginning of a conversation with a customer in the context of a company like Twist, where the software needs to provide information about why something has been flagged. And then the company can go back to the customer and say, why have you decided to order this? Is it in line with what your company does? If necessary, has this been approved by a biosafety officer? Are there any sort of export control approvals that we need to have in place before it's okay to ship to the customer? So it's sort of the beginning of a conversation. In the case of a benchtop synthesis device, there may not be an immediate sort of synchronous conversation with the customer. So in that sort of circumstance, it might be that a flag is a stop, so the customer cannot produce DNA on the fly as they might if it wasn't flagged, but they can then go back to the benchtop device provider and appeal the flag and get an override to produce a piece of DNA if they are an appropriate customer to produce that type of sequence. So it might be that individual customers have exemption lists of DNA that they would work with routinely that would normally be cause for a flag, but for example, if they're a virus research lab, they're approved to work with that virus, then they can print that DNA. There might be other companies that don't have the resources to perform this follow-up discussion or the expertise to conduct it, so they may choose to, under certain circumstances of a flag, not proceed and not take on that risk and only produce sequences that are unambiguously cleared, safe, not subject to key regulatory constraints that they need to take into account. So we're trying to satisfy a wide range of providers, and it's been really helpful to talk to the technical consortium and understand those different needs and what our different user profiles might be. Yeah, the flags are treated a bit differently depending on the user, and they can decide sort of what course they want to take depending on their staffing and their individual business practices.
Great. Any comments from the panel on either the first question or the second question?
So I'd be keen to pick up on where Nicole left off, which is, Jamie, as you mentioned, we don't really have a whole lot of national systems. Embedded in your question was, are we going to tell regulators? Well, the question to that is, do regulators want to know? And this is a fantastic opportunity for countries as they're figuring out nationally what their procedures and practices should be. This is a new tool. And that's the answer to the second question is we're building tools to help exactly those users make that differentiation. At the moment, we basically offload that decision-making process to people's companies, academics, institutions, that's not their day job. So building better tools to help that decision-making process is what we're trying to do here, is to enable that. But just to come back to the idea of the national frameworks, if countries decide that their regulators should know which academics or which institutions or which companies are accessing certain types of DNA, that would be a national decision. That will, at the moment, that's not something that's ever been possible before. Right now, that is exactly the sort of question that countries can consider, that countries can think about. And it would be really, really exciting to see countries invest in thinking about next generation oversight frameworks that could take advantage of some of these new procedures and tools and technologies to build better defenses.
And I'll just add on to that this is also a really valuable opportunity for harmonization of a lot of the ways that the industry right now is dealing with evaluating these flag sequences, that's generally subject to policies and procedures that have been developed within each individual company. And so there's likely some heterogeneity across the industry, and I think there's a really valuable contribution that IBBIS may be able to make here, which is to say, like, here's a risk framework for how you should think about the risk posed by a sequence or by customers based on a bunch of attributes, and harmonize the way that companies approach the evaluation of these flag sequences.
Maybe to react on your point, Nicole. So the way we've been thinking about it for the benchtop side of things, or at least for our products, is to make sure that the customer's screening is giving a certain level of rights in terms of sequence screening process. So it means essentially certain types of users will be enabled to do certain types of sequence printing activities, where another set of users may not be able to do that. And the reason is fairly straightforward, right? If you're a vaccine development company, of course you're going to need to be able to work with specific antigens that are associated with viruses and pathogens, right? So you need those vaccine developers, as an example, to be able to do that work. On the other end, maybe smaller private entities that are less understood, less well known, may not benefit from those rights. So that's how we're thinking about it. In a way, our preference would be to embed it a little bit earlier in the process, so that you don't have to go back to the users all the time in terms of routine operations.
I just wanted to add one more piece, which is how this all ties back to security. And I think this is the question is a classic example of some of the trade-offs that we're seeing as we look to balance what it takes to run an effective industry where customers feel confident and they trust their DNA provider, and what is the threshold at which we say, you know what, something here looks fishy, maybe we should tell law enforcement. And that's a really tough question, but an important one, because fundamentally, DNA synthesis screening is a frontline defense against selling, you know, the building blocks of dangerous pathogens to people who shouldn't have them, either because they don't have the biosafety set up and they're not trained, or because they may have malicious intent. And I think if this system, as we're trying to build it, like in an ideal version going forward, we would also like it to, if there's really extensive sniffing around and probing the system to see what you can order, and if you keep on trying to probe the system and keep getting blocked, at some point it should raise a flag where it's egregious enough that we should be telling law enforcement. Because what part of the thing that we're trying to solve here from a security perspective is there's it's a needle in a haystack problem. Massive amount of activity of sale of DNA, synthetic DNA, 99.99999% of it is legitimate and beneficial, but maybe there's a needle in a haystack where someone's trying to exploit the system. And I think if it's working really well, we would love to be able to have a chance of catching that needle in a haystack. And I think we have many of the building blocks, but I think there's still more work to be done to pull these different pieces together and figure out what's the right threshold where we feel like it's effective from a biosecurity perspective, but it still works for industry. And so I think that's where the collaboration, the ongoing partnership can continue to bear fruit.
So, Jamie, one of the things you mentioned that really sort of I think I'd like to reinforce to this audience is not only the size of the gene synthesis in orders and industry and what exists, but really how international that is. This, in my view, is not the preserve of a few states. This is not something that BWC states parties can offload to a handful of countries and require a national regime. First of all, as we've heard, those national approaches interlink, and it's important to have a broader international understanding of what is happening in this particular space, but also that synthetic genes, synthetic DNA, are being used by scientists and engineers and companies all over the world. This is not just a handful of companies. You know, in previous roles I've been involved in international science and engineering in the biological arena, and it's every continent, it's every country. This is not a weird advanced bit of technology that something like the Biological Weapons Convention can afford to say, well, this is the future, this is a handful of countries. This is international, it's here, it's now. You can see the companies with us who are actually making business out of selling either DNA or machines to make DNA. So really, it's a plea to think about this as something that needs to be addressed now.
Great. So let's see if there are more questions. Are there more people who'd like to make a comment or a question? Please raise your hand, and Chris will come to you with the mic. Yes, please.
I'm Nadia Jamil from Pakistan. I have one question that the presentation that was very informative and interesting, but some people might not even know how biosecurity and biosafety is related to DNA synthesis. So do you intend to do any webinars and series like that to create awareness among other people who doesn't even know about it or the consequences that if something goes wrong about it? And second thing is that you said that there are no international laws about it. So do you intend to collaborate with other countries and do something and generate a common set of guidelines in collaboration with the other countries? Thank you.
Thank you. Comments from the panel?
I'm super happy to jump in on the international questions there. So just to flip them around to start with the second piece, very keen to work with everybody internationally, collaboratively, very keen to explore how something like this could be useful in the context of Pakistan. And also, you know, more broadly, I think that there is an... My vision... I'll get on to my vision of IBBIS later on, but my vision for IBBIS is peace and security is going to be so strong, so good in the future, we won't need organizations like IBBIS. I'm deliberately trying to build myself out of a job before I've started my job properly. So I'm looking forward to a future where that's the case. But just to give you an anecdote of why the common mechanism is so important, why what we're talking about is so important, I remember the first time that the International Genetically Engineered Machines Competition had a team from Pakistan. That team struggled because when they were sent the parts, which is exactly what we're talking about now, the parts to make engineered biological machines, they sat in the customs building for somewhere around 3 months because the customs folks didn't really know what the risks were involved with the materials that were being shipped into Pakistan. These tools should help decision makers, should help build national systems where scientists and engineers, young scientists and engineers in Pakistan, instead of having the last 2 weeks of their project to work with these materials, could have had 3 months to work with these materials. So I think this is an enabling way to be able to get the things that we want around the world to do amazing things with biotechnology there quicker, faster, and easier, and enable scientists to be able to do that.
Great. Thanks, Piers. I'll also build on some of Piers' comments and take a stab at offering additional thoughts on both of your questions. So the first question is, how do we build awareness of this internationally? And I would say, so NTI, as we work to spin up IBBIS, has engaged in a number of activities because we agree with you that raising awareness around this issue is critical. I would say today's event, this is our most public-facing event that we've had so far to talk about these issues and to talk about IBBIS, and so this is part of the work. Hello to our participants online who are watching this and streaming, but we've done a number of other activities. So. A couple of us participated last week in the Global Technology Summit in India, where we were working to raise awareness in India and among participants at the meeting of these same issues, understanding the risks, understanding what are some of the challenges and solutions, and talking about the tools that we've been talking about today. And we're going to continue to work to raise awareness so more and more people in countries around the world can understand this. I also want to make a plug for the Global Biosecurity Dialogue, which NTI Bio has been running for a number of years. We're grateful for support from Canada, and Trevor Smith has been supporting this work from the start. We've done a lot of work on the African continent that has been linked to the Global Partnership Signature Initiative for Biosafety and Biosecurity. My colleague, Haley Severance, has played an important role in building and leading that effort, and that's another way in which we're trying to spread the word internationally around these issues to raise awareness and build capacity. We also think as IBBIS spins up, I think IBBIS is also going to play a key role in raising awareness around these issues and continuing to work with experts in countries around the world to develop a shared vision for how to tackle these challenges. And in terms of international norms, you know, so I think the point we made is there's no international standard for DNA synthesis screening. And so I think you know, I think Piers and I have been talking about this, and we've been talking among the team, and I think we're in enthusiastic agreement that IBBIS can play a really important role here. It can play a convening role to bring together stakeholders from countries around the world to talk about what an international norm and set of standards could look like. I think industry will play an important role. Members of the IGSC, including those represented here today, have been thinking about developing a common standard, and so we're going to be working closely with industry. There's potentially a room, as Piers, as you were saying last night at dinner, to bring in the ISO standards to think about whether we could codify this in an ISO standard. So there's a lot of technical work that we can do together, but it has to be done in an international way, and we think IBBIS is really well positioned to facilitate that discussion and provide some of the technical support to carry it forward, recognizing that a lot of people have day jobs. They don't have time to do this on their own. But thank you for those great questions. Additional questions or comments from the group? Wilmot.
Thank you very much for your presentation. So the biggest risk, one of the biggest risks in the developing world is agro-bioterrorism. So my question is whether you have a One Health approach to this, looking at both plant, animal, and human biosecurity. If you can think of a pathogen, if you can think about the abuse of gene drives, for example, doing the same work that locusts do in East Africa in terms of destroying crops, that potential is something that would catch the attention of governments in the developing world, because you're dealing with food security and it's linked to synthetic biology applications in agriculture.
I mean, I the reason I'm interested in this question is it raises the lack of tooling to predict biological risk more broadly. So right now, a lot of these screening systems are looking at homology to sequences that we know are involved in pathogens. So from that perspective, we do detect things like plant pathogens, animal pathogens, and human pathogens in these screening tools. So that is certainly covered. I think when you start asking questions about gene drives or the other sort of biological outcomes that are more kind of the outcome of multiple biological components working in concert, there we really don't have the tooling to do that kind of risk estimation. And I think that's another opportunity both for IBBIS to provide a leadership role and for national governments to invest on the research side in building those tools that then companies like IGSC members could use to carry out that risk estimation in a much more informative way.
And I'm just going to combine in there antimicrobial resistance, right? I mean, if you're looking about biological parts that have risk, we're in Geneva, we're talking about the Biological Weapons Convention and deliberate misuse, but thanks for opening it out to food security and other issues. And I think antimicrobial resistance also needs to go on that list, because these are factors that operate in a biological way that could pose a risk, mainly from that accidental side, that we need to be thinking about and that aren't necessarily integrated into current screening practices.
Yeah, I briefly chime in from the software side as well. One of the key considerations when we were developing the common mechanism was adaptability. So some of the databases that go into the common mechanism are the specific sequences that we think we need to flag and the organisms that need to be flagged, and they are not hard-coded in, so it can be individual companies can add their own sequences if they think that those are important, or under certain contexts of where the customer is located and where the provider is located, you can change the lists of organisms that are subject to regulations. So it's designed to be extensible and flexible as global norms change. And as we start to negotiate different international regulations. The antimicrobial resistance point is actually a really important one, because it's a tough consideration in DNA synthesis screening. A lot of people need to order antimicrobial resistance genes for laboratory work. And there's a very big difference between a widely distributed resistance mechanism that's already common in what you're working with and ordering resistance mechanisms to a wide range of drugs in a single order. And it comes back to this sort of systems level problem of, at the moment, we look at biological parts independently and individually without considering the system and the construct as a whole. So there's definitely discussions that we've been having around DNA synthesis screening as well as genome engineering about how we can start to think more holistically about risk and where we are from a technical capabilities side of whether that's plausible at the moment and how it would be put into practice.
And so I just wanted to add on to that, just a sort of bigger picture zooming out. So, I mean, these kinds of comments and questions are really helpful. I mean, part of the work that we're trying to do here is get feedback from governments and other parts of the biosecurity community about where the need is. Because as Piers mentioned a few minutes ago, IBBIS is fundamentally meant to be a resource to governments and others who want to do the right thing for biosecurity. And so we would welcome thoughts on what other additional priorities IBBIS should take on as it looks to expand its work up beyond the scope of DNA synthesis screening. And so that kind of feedback is immensely valuable. We can think about it in terms of building it into existing technical systems like the common mechanism that Nicole is talking about, and thinking about whether there are specific technologies that we have to do risk assessment and figure out if there's an additional specific approach that we should be thinking about. And the other thing I'll just mention is that NTI, in addition to supporting IBBIS as it spins up and his peers, hires more people, so he's not 100% of the organization, we're going to continue to support them in the coming years, and we're going to try to spin out pilot projects. So doing various experiments in governance and figuring out what other tools can we build that are concretely useful to address real concerns and needs that governments and others have. And so would really encourage folks in the community to continue to come to us with ideas about what we should be prioritizing and where we should focus. So thank you for that question.
Jamie,
yes, please.
One last thing on the G drive on the G drive aspect of your question. It's what's interesting in from my perspective is that you really have two levels. One is of course at the DNA level, but then there is a gene editing level that's asking the question of the organism layer, and the organism also is subject to a completely different set of regulation that are usually nation-related, right? Because we're essentially, at least in the EU or the US, you would end up with a GMO question. So in my mind, your question is actually much broader than just the DNA synthesis screening part. It's raising other questions like GMOs, right?
Great, thank you. Would welcome more comments and questions from the group, so please raise your hand if you'd like to share an intervention. Chris, there's another question right here.
Yeah, just go back to your latest question about how for government to help you understand what is needed. I think most governments have regulations and rules that controls the use of pathogens and toxins, and not necessarily the use of the technology, right? So understanding what that technology can create, for instance, what would that technology create in terms of pathogens and toxins? What are the risk level of those pathogens and toxins would be very helpful to government in terms of actually revising their oversight system to capture those technologies which are gonna create these pathogens. So that is one of the gaps which the link between industry and your organization in terms of identifying those pathogens and toxins that could be created by this kind of technology is quite important for government to understand that. So working with government on that particular level will be key for government to be able to actually manage their oversight systems to capture some of this risk. So that is something I can put out there for you.
Thank you. Yeah, no, that's amazingly useful, and it's a perfect springboard to make sure that we've reinforced that message that that historically governments have done exactly that. They've found pathogens, microbes that cause harm in humans, animals, and plants. Thanks, Wilmot. To place additional levels of oversight and governance on. But increasingly, the research and development that's happening around the world isn't happening at that pathogen level. It's not the whole organism. Scientists and engineers are using parts, are using just fragments of that. And it's really hard to determine which bits we should be worried about and which bits we shouldn't be worried about. And I know James and I know Sylvain, this is something that you've had to deal with from a very operational level. And part of the problem in the past is that's been a gap. It's just been, well, we know we should worry about something. You guys have companies, you worry about it. And what we need is tools to enable them and to you and all of those users around the world to be able to have better decision making. That's exactly what we're here to do, is to figure out how you break that down below the organism level, below the pathogen level, to be able to figure out which bits we may want to produce, to place greater degrees of oversight on, and which bits we're not really worried about. Even if they seem to come from like nasty bugs that cause nasty things, they may not actually pose a greater risk. I mean, I don't know if anybody else wants to jump in on this, but thank you for that. To reinforce that is a rare opportunity, so thank you.
Yeah, I'll just chime in to build on Piers's comment, which is, I mean, I think fundamentally what we're trying to do is modernize our collective approach to biosecurity. I think there are parts of biosecurity that we've been doing for years. We've been thinking about how to safeguard laboratories and how to safeguard pathogen stocks, to do personnel, you know, reliability. A lot of those practices are pretty clear about how to operationalize those aspects. There's still a lot of capacity building and investment that needs to happen so that we can bring those traditional practices up to standard in countries around the world, and that's really important. But I think as we have been discussing and as you emphasized in your comment, that is important but not sufficient. We need to think about how this landscape, how the risk is changing, and how what's possible is changing over time, and how do we build on our traditional biosecurity practice to incorporate modern bioscience and biotechnology so that the approach that we take is comprehensive and really meaningfully reduces risk and is evolving as the technology evolves and doesn't get left behind by the rapid pace of advances. And I think there's some work to be done in capacity building and awareness raising and sort of taking the things that we already know and trying to get by and in practices globally, but there's a lot of innovation and creative thinking that we need to engage in to build new tools, as Piers was saying, and new systems. I mean, we're trying to build the plane while we're trying to fly it at the same time, and so we have, this is why we're really committed to this work. I know, you know, really excited that, you know, Piers is committed to leading IBBIS, and we're committed to supporting them and helping build these tools so that we can so that companies and academic researchers and publishers and funders and governments have the tools that they need to do this well, because I just don't think we're there right now. We have a lot of creative work to do to get there, and it's important. So thank you. Any other comments or questions from the group? Please, right here in the front, Chris.
Hello, my name is Dana. I'm from MIT, and my graduate work is actually in DNA screening. So I was curious, I guess that's only partially relevant. What I'm curious about is the reward mechanisms that you mentioned, which I think is a really fascinating and great thing to look into more. I was curious if you had any specific ideas about how journals could be rewarded for good practice, or how funders might be rewarded for good practice, or any of the other categories. I'm just curious if you had thoughts.
I think the incentives question is really key. There have been discussions around this. I'm not sure we've got the right answer yet. I think this is one of those areas where that IBBIS could be really useful if having a broader discussion of that, and priming the pump for other bodies like the World Health Organization or the BWC to investigate those issues in a couple of years' time when thinking has matured a little bit. But I think there's a number of ways. First of all, I mentioned the seal of approval. That may be something that is useful to have some visible way that marks out those companies and organizations that have invested time and effort to think about biosecurity, to have a visible symbol. So when users are selecting which company or which platform or who to go with and who to partner with, that may be part of the decision making to be able to say, well, that's great, this company, this organization over here believes in the same sorts of things that I believe in and is part of that global network of trying to solve this biosecurity problem. So that's one piece. Then there are some slightly more cutthroat approaches of saying, well, once you've done that, what does that mean for liability? If you're actively demonstrating you are part of the solution here, does that have implications as far as funding choices? If you're going down the research line, would it be a good thing when research funders are choosing which projects to fund? If you came to the table with a robust plan about how you're managing risks from that, and a very coherent argument about why the benefits of the work outweigh any risks of the work, maybe that feeds into funding decisions and that opens doors that wouldn't otherwise exist. It's a little bit harder when you get to the publication stage, but I think there it's also, it's important to remember we have seen public backlashes in this space. I was amazed when we were, if you go back a few years to the original sort of gain of function H5N1 discussions, that we saw headlines from major popular press criticizing the scientists. That's really unusual. Normally, as we've seen in the last couple of years, scientists are a powerful force for good. They can do amazing things. To see public questioning whether gain of function research should be publicly funded, that's eye-opening. I guess I'm moving towards how do we frame some of the research we need to do in a way that is engenders public support, that really frames it as something that collectively as societies, you know, taking my hat off from IBBIS and putting my hat on as just a member of the public, that this is exciting work that I want to see done and that I believe should be done, and how do we move towards broader public support for some of those areas? Well, it's in some of the framing questions, I think.
Great, and I'll just add to that. I think, you know, we're trying to, I think your question is really important because fundamentally, if we're going to succeed in this work together, we need to align incentives for professional success of companies or individual scientists or institutions with biosecurity best practices. And I think, and that's what's motivating a lot of our work. I think, unfortunately, sometimes those incentive structures are pointing in the opposite direction. Biosecurity is pointing toward caution and restraint, but there's tremendous pressure to publish, to try out new and innovative things, to be in the media, to sort of push the boundaries of what's possible. And so we're trying to find a way to align the incentive structures so they're not pointing the opposite direction. I think, you know, some basic principles that I think carry out across not only funders and publishers, as you mentioned, but I think at all these different intervention points throughout the life cycle is two things. One is we should assume that all of these gatekeepers want to do the right thing, but it's hard to do the right thing because they don't have the tools and resources. So if you build tools to make it easier for funders to conduct a pre-funding biosecurity review, and so they don't have to make it up or improvise, and there's something that feels meaningful, that could make it easier for them. So tools to enable it, and that could be true for publishers as well. And I think the other thing is positive brand value, which I think, you know, Piers is talking about. Like, there's reputational benefit and gain to be seen as being a leading positive stakeholder in the community who's doing the right thing. And so we want to set up systems that will give credit to companies that are doing the right thing in terms of screening at a good standard, which is why we're looking at a seal of approval. We're looking at something called a biofunders compact as one of our biosecurity funders compact as one of our initial pilot projects to figure out, can we get a bunch of public and private funders to sign a public pledge that says we commit to do a pre-funding biosecurity review and we're only going to fund things that we think pass our responsibility test, and then give them the tools to do that. And so if we can build these kinds of tools and structures, we're hopeful that we can start to move the needle and create the kind of incentives that you're talking about. I don't think it's easy. I think we're going to have to try stuff and experiment. But I think sort of being willing to be risk tolerant and try things and experiment is part of the spirit of this work, and I think it's how we're going to find solutions most efficiently. So I see we're at about 9:15, and we're going to go back to peers in a moment, but I wanted to see if there are any last burning comments or questions from the group. Trevor.
Thank you, Jamie, and to the entire panel. My name is Trevor Smith with Global Affairs Canada, and Piers, I hate asking the same question twice, but I'm going to ask you a question I asked you on your first day in the job when IBBIS was launched in Berlin in early October. And it's about the relationship with international organizations and with WHO in particular. Now that you've had a couple months to think about this and consider the WHO global guidance on responsible conduct in the life sciences, how do you see the work that IBBIS will do, not just being aware of that, but dovetailing with it and recognizing that you are similar tools in the same toolbox? The other aspect of the question I'm curious about, and I'm doing this mindful of the fact that many of us are here for the Biological and Toxin Weapons Convention. There's ignorance and arrogance that can lead to an oops, which can be just as bad, but there's also malevolence, where things are done very deliberately. As I'm listening to the IBBIS mission, which is very noble, I think it's geared more towards the former, preventing accidental or inadvertent misuse of science, as opposed to the latter, which is where there's that real intersection with the BTWC, which is the maliciousness, people who are deliberately trying to do wrong. would welcome your thought, particularly on that latter bit about would IBBIS have any role in dealing with those who are deliberately trying to do something for very illegitimate reasons. Thanks.
Thanks, Trevor. In fact, I think the two are closely connected. So I think, thanks for the question about the WHO guidance. I'm a great believer in that document. I think it's an incredible contribution to the field that we're all interested in. I think where the role of IBBIS is going from the 30,000-foot version of the guidance that we have now that has to fit in every country in every context and creates a framework that needs to be implemented down to the question of how do we implement it? What does that mean practically in institutions and organizations around the world? Now, I know WHO wants to build layers of tools and resources underneath their guidance to make that happen. That is a huge job. That is where IBBIS can help them. That is where things like the common mechanism are a practical applied tool that can be actually translate the aims and objectives, the guidance framework that now exists at the international level into operational activities that happen inside companies, inside institutions, globally. And that is a mission space that is so big that it goes beyond even into governmental organizations. WHO cannot do that alone. I speak as having consulted with WHO on other related projects for a long time. I know it's a fantastic organization, but there is a role for all of us in helping them to accomplish that. So I think that's the first thing I would say is to get down to that where the rubber hits the road, to use that phrase, that's where we can help. And that comes back to something I should have said when we were introducing IBBIS. At the moment, there is no international organization whose primary mission is to look at the risks, emerging risks coming from advances in biotechnology. There are organizations who have other roles that do that as part of their mandate, but they're not focused day in, day out about the potential harms that come from advances in biotechnology. That is what IBBIS can do. And that's where it sits. It's less about the laboratory biosecurity of the threat reduction programs, which I know are very close to your heart and that you've spent decades around the world building capacity in. It's more about how do we deal with these dual-use capabilities, unpacking that dual-use problem. And that's something else that, you know, that's what IBBIS will be that is different to what anybody else is doing. Yes, there are groups inside WHO that are doing that, and they have a fantastic capacity to look both at horizon scanning and at the dual use issue. But again, I think there's enough room there for us to all be looking at that. And I'm going to be very careful how I say this. Sometimes with intergovernmental organizations, it's complicated to work with the private sector. The perception of conflicts of interest drive intergovernmental organizations to be quite risk averse. Jamie mentioned on numerous occasions that IBBIS will be much more risk tolerant than some of the framework that exists. The idea is to de-risk some of these tools. The first time I remember IGSC briefing the Biological Weapons Convention was coming on 10 years ago. The BWC doesn't have a common mechanism, not because they don't know about it, not because it's a new thing they haven't heard about or didn't think about, but because it's quite risky. It's hard for an intergovernmental organization. What's it going to cost? What's it going to look like? What's the algorithm going to be? Countries, governments, diplomats, policymakers want to see the reality of things and know what that means for them before they can engage with it. So one of the things that IBBIS can do is to build some of these tools, show it to government, demonstrate how it can work. And this is what I promised last comment, trying to get myself out of my own job. If it's successful, I would love to see something like the common mechanism or an international screening system embedded in an intergovernmental organization in a few years' time. If WHO came along and said, hey, in 2025, this works, we want this. I don't know what anybody else on the panel will go, but I would be saying, yes, please take it. You know, make it part of an intergovernmental organization, make it part of the architecture. But how do we get from where we are now to there? IBBIS is part of that answer.
So I just want to build on that because I think, so that's a great answer. And I think, Trevor, your second question is equally important, which is how does this relate to security? Is this really going to help guard against deliberate misuse? And I appreciate that you pulled that thread because I don't think we're really explicit about the theory of change and our interest in getting through the presentation quickly, but I think it's important to be very clear about what we mean. And I would say, you know, as part of the mission statement, IBBIS is designed to guard against both accidental and deliberate misuse. And the way that we're thinking about that, and we would welcome your thoughts, is basically we want to safeguard the legitimate global bioscience and biotechnology enterprise against exploitation by malicious actors. And so I think there are two really key pieces to that. One is to make sure that it's really hard for malicious actors to gain access to the goods and services and equipment that are embedded in this legitimate infrastructure. I think DNA synthesis screening is a classic example of the kind of tools we're trying to build, so we're trying to make it harder for malicious actors to get stuff that they could use to make a bioweapon. But there are lots of other capabilities and technologies that we have to build analogous safeguards for. So I think the DNA synthesis screening is a model, but we need to expand that to other contexts. And I think the other reason is we want to guard against what is sometimes referred to as information hazards. We don't want to see journals continuing to publish excessively risky dual-use research that could produce a roadmap to make it easier for otherwise unsophisticated actors to synthesize or engineer a dangerous pathogen. And so usually, like, any one publication isn't going to change the world, but if you have an endless stream of publications that are constantly releasing more and more information, you have a body of knowledge in the public domain that reflects the sort of tacit knowledge of the leading scientists in the field, and in aggregate, that exacerbates risk. And so that's a really hard problem, but I think one that we need to tackle if we're really serious about the security piece of this. I think the last thing I'll say about this is, like, I think this is very powerful and effective against non-state actors. It's unclear how effective this will be in shaping state work, because it's hard to constrain capability of states. They have a lot more resources. And so I think that's a little bit harder, but certainly I think this is a very effective approach personally for dealing with non-state actor risks. But thank you for the question. Those are really important questions. And
Jamie, I want to go a little bit broader, because I think, yes, certainly non-state actors. But my fundamental starting point with biosecurity tools is there isn't going to be a silver bullet. There is not going to be one tool that solves everything. There is not going to be a tool that prevents a powerful actor from being able to acquire and use biological weapons. What we have to do is to put in place a lot of different mm-hmm. small hurdles that, for the benign actor that's doing something positive, easy to step over. I was talking last night that I could probably make it over one single hurdle. I could probably jump over a hurdle like the international sport hurdles. But if you ask me to do five in a row, I promise you I'm going to trip up. How do we apply that model to biosecurity so that the benign actor has got to jump over one and then they go on their way? But the malign actor suddenly is trying to get over hurdle after hurdle over after hurdle. And that means it's that layered defense that we talked about. And I think this is a key part of that.
Great. Thank you. So actually now we're almost at time, and I want to respect everyone's time who's joined us this morning, and so that folks can get down to plenary discussions at 10. So we have a few minutes left. You have the closing words, peers. If you want to just share a few closing thoughts about IBBIS, and then also we have a nifty video to share with the group.
So I kind of stole my own thunder, and thanks, Trevor, for the question, because that's where I was going to go in the final remarks, was to talk about how do we move from the sorts of things that you've been talking about in the Biological Weapons Convention last week and this week and next week, about these very big international aims. This is a multilateral global forum setting the scene for the world on how to maximize the benefits from the life sciences and biotechnology whilst trying to manage a specific sector of risks. What that looks like in Geneva at a diplomatic meeting is quite different from what it has to look like around the world, inside your countries, inside your institutions. There is almost never-ending opportunity to bring in more people from more places to have a better discussion about what we need to do and the tools we need to do it. And I think that, for me, is where IBBIS is going to sit. It is as something to enable countries, to enable companies, to enable diplomats and policymakers to be able to do their job, cheaper, better, faster, easier, right? This is a platform for you to help move the needle on the thing that you're here to talk about. I won't go into more detail than that, because I think we've done that through what we were talking about. This is the first time anywhere in the world that anybody's seen the first IBBIS video. So this is the global launch of this video, and I don't want to stand in the way of making that work. So I hope you enjoy it as much as I enjoy it. So let's see if I can make it play.
One more time.
Extraordinarily exciting time in terms of advances in science and technology. But we have to recognize that there are serious risks that accompany those advances.
The biggest hazards in the world of biotechnology today and biosciences today is accidental and deliberate releases of pathogens into the environment.
Biosecurity is not limited to one lab. It's not limited to one country. It is basically a problem that transcends borders.
Using tools like the Global Health Security Index, we know that most countries in the world don't have policies in place to guard against misuse of biological science.
Without internationally recognized and accepted norms, it then becomes difficult to encourage people to comply.
While the World Health Organization and the Biological Weapons Convention are both doing really critically important work, the fact of the matter is that there's no international entity that's dedicated as its top priority to reducing emerging biological risks associated with rapid advances in science and technology.
That's why we're moving forward with the International Biosecurity and Biosafety Initiative for Science, IBBIS. IBBIS will collaborate with global partners from governments to private industry to academia to strengthen biosecurity norms and develop innovative tools to uphold them.
IBBIS can play a unique role in bringing together all those different actors dealing with biosecurity implications across these different areas and really providing that space to act as a lighthouse that will add value to the work of these organizations.
Cross-sector collaboration is essential because when building global actionable norms, every sector has a role to play.
One of the first things that IBBIS can do is really look at technologies and tools that already exist, tools like DNA synthesis.
We know from experience that the DNA synthesis can also be misused. An initiative like IBBIS can make sure that the DNA synthesis is being used properly and not to create any kind of harm.
Some of the technologies involved in screening are really expensive to build and maintain, and they require a lot of expertise to operate and interpret. And access to those can be quite limited globally. IBBIS plans to address some of these shortcomings by first building one of these screening systems and making it broadly available, which has never been done before. That will help to democratize access to these sorts of systems and increase global biosecurity generally.
Having technology that allows researchers to have access to custom DNA much more quickly just shortens the whole research cycle, and that's, I think that's really priceless.
Biotechnology moves very fast. This is an area that we need to keep with the pace and rate of change of innovation.
The vision that's driving IBBIS is to create a world where bioscience and biotechnology can fulfill their immense promise. National and global leaders, as well as the scientific community, have a moral obligation to safeguard against global catastrophic risks.
Scientific activities and technology, they have no borders, and the risk has also no borders. If we want to have a safer world, we need to have a joint efforts globally for the biosecurity issues.
Because if there's a gap somewhere in the system, everybody's at risk.
IBBIS will be able to fill that gap by both building norms, strengthening our policy, but also to develop very practical tools to be able to solve those problems that will come tomorrow and the day after that.
Great. Well, thank you so much for joining us and for your excellent questions. Really delighted to have the opportunity to share this work with you, and we'll be sticking around for a little while longer if folks have any other comments or questions for anyone on the panel or anyone from our colleagues. So thank you so much. Wishing you productive discussions at the BWC Review Conference, and thank you for your time.